The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Saint Luke. Chapter 4, verses 16 to 21. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogues on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of the sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The Gospel of the Lord.
My dear brothers and sisters, the Gospel today is a great news. A good news to every one of us. All of us are struggling with our passions going out of control, with our desires leading us to wrong actions, and because of all that, a lot of misery coming into our lives. In the first reading today, Saint Paul explains to us the pain of our heart steeped in sin. Saying it in the first person, Paul said, "I don't understand what is happening to me. I want to be good, but somehow I'm not able to be good. I end up doing the wrong." My dear sisters and brothers, all of us will be able to identify ourselves with this sad predicament. All of us want to be good. Is there anyone here who wants to be bad? Hands up. No hand is going up. None of us wants to be bad. None of us wants to be lazy. None of us wants to be angry. None of us wants to be frightened. All of us want to be happy and holy and gentle and cheerful and loving everyone around us. And yet, is that what is happening? When we make a very honest soul searching, we would understand there are powers of sin dwelling in our hearts. And that's what Saint Paul is telling us. There are powers of evil dwelling in my heart, making me a captive. Captive means a slave. A slave is not free. A slave is compelled into a way of thinking, a style of living. And Paul is saying, that's what a sinful heart is. A heart addicted to sin is a heart that's being pulled and pushed by unholy desires, evil ways of living. "Wretched man that I am," And you and I said it. At one time or other, you and I said it. But then, after having said it, Paul turns to Jesus. And the face of the risen Lord appears before him. And Paul tells Jesus, "Jesus, thanks be to you. You are my Savior." Hallelujah. Shall all of us say hallelujah? Shall we raise our hands up and say hallelujah? Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Now, why does Paul say this? Why does, after having confessed the wretchedness of the heart, why does he say, "Thanks be to Jesus," in a loving exclamation, exaltation, praising and thanking God? Because in Jesus, Paul experiences the fullness of liberation. God understands me as I am. God loves me as I am. God accepts me as I am. And God holds me close to his heart, however sinful I am. And that's the good news. The good news that Jesus came to proclaim to us. And that's what we heard in the gospel today. Now, this was the first proclamation of Jesus, our Savior. Our Savior. That's what Jesus is. That's what Jesus came to save us. To save us from everything disturbing, everything upsetting, everything enslaving, everything frightening, and to set us free. Set us free that we may live in joy and peace and love. And that was the first message of Jesus after having prayed in the silent life for 30 years. Jesus was baptized by John in Jordan, and then Jesus went up to the mountain to fast 40 days and 40 nights. After the fast, Jesus came down. Jesus came down and began to preach. What the angel said in Bethlehem is now being realized. It's coming true. Jesus said, I'm come to give you the good news. And what's the good news? We are told Jesus entered the synagogue and he got the Bible, the Old Testament, and he searched for the passage where God promises salvation through the prophecy of Isaiah. Jesus chose that particular passage, we are told. And what's the passage? A good news, an acceptable, a favorable year of the Lord, a time of God's favor. Why is the time of God's favor? Because he has sent me, he has anointed me with the Holy Spirit to proclaim this good news. And what's the good news? Freedom to captives, liberation to the oppressed, and sight to the blind. Now, who's the captive? And that's what St. Paul told us. And Jesus said earlier, John 8:34, Jesus said, a sinner is a slave of sin. A sinner is always tossed about from temptation to temptation, from oppression to oppression, and enslaved by the powers of evil. And that's what a slave is. A slave is a person who's not free to be good, who's not free to act good. A slave is a person who is determined determined to be bad, to be living a wrong type of life. Now, Jesus is giving the good news. The good news is freedom for those who are enslaved to sin. What's more interesting is, after reading this offer of salvation that God offered through prophet Isaiah, after reading this, Jesus looked at the people, looked at everyone sitting there, and Jesus said, in your hearing, this word is come true. In your hearing, this word is come true. Hallelujah. 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 What is the word come true? The word come true is the word of salvation, the promise of salvation, freedom for captives, liberation for the oppressed, sight to the blind. This promise given by God through prophet Isaiah is come true in your hearing. And that means in Jesus, this promise, this prophecy is realized. And therefore, everyone who believes in Jesus, everyone who offers his life, her life in the hands of Jesus, will experience freedom from slavery, forgiveness of sin, and sight to the blind. And that's how Jesus started his first preaching. The brothers and sisters, a young man once came to me. He was an IT engineer and he looked very sad. I asked him, my friend, why are you so sad? He said, Father, I'm a wretched man. I don't want to live. I thought of committing suicide, killing myself, but I'm afraid. I don't want to live, but I can't die as well. I'm come to you, Father, in this wretched, helpless situation. I asked him what happened. Explain to me what was happening to him. He said, in the evening, he comes home, he would be very tired, because for an IT engineer to meet all the targets given by the management would be very tough. And he would work hard and late. He would come home just wanting to go to bed and rest. But he said, when he comes home and enters his room and sees the computer with an internet connection, all the tiredness vanishes. He would sit at the computer and he said his fingers would move automatically on the keyboard, and the fingers would bring in the dirty, filthy, pornographic sites of the internet. And he would go on watching them, devouring all those dirty pictures. And he said, when he watched them, he would understand it was wrong. It was inhuman. He should not be looking at them. And he said, I would never be able to shut down the computer. When he goes to bed, it would be very late. And when he sleeps, all those atrocious scenes he watched on the computer would come back to him and haunt him. He would never be able to sleep well. He would get up in the morning more tired than when he went to bed. He would wash himself. He has to go to the office. And he would go and sit at the breakfast table. That's when his sister would be coming. His dear sister would be coming all dressed up to go to college. He said, Father, when I look at my sister, I would feel terrible. I have lost the eyes of her brother. You understand what that means? I have lost the eyes of her brother. All those terrible sights I looked at would come back to me, superimposed on the body of my sister. I would not be able to look at my sister with holy eyes. Often I would not be able to take breakfast at all because I would feel so wretched, so guilty, so dirty, and I would make a decision never to repeat that again. But he said, in the evening when he comes home, the same thing again, same thing again. The next day morning, he would feel wretched and terrible and guilty, and he would make a decision and again do the same. He said he felt totally helpless. He went to a counselor and he opened up his heart. Whatever he was doing day in and day out, the counselor was very angry with him. The counselor told him, how can you do this? How can you visit such unholy sites on the computer? How can he look at those terrible pornographic sites? Your eyes will burn in hell. Your body will be eaten up by worms. The counselor threatened him. And he felt terrible. He felt more guilty. When he felt more guilty, he was pushed into the same sinful behavior pattern. Again, he felt wretched. Then he went to a friend and told him, poured out his heart. His friend laughed aloud and said, oh, my dear man, everyone does it today. What's the big thing? You don't hurt anyone, do you? You look at those pictures as much as you want. What's the problem? He felt consoled, and yet, there was guilt burning into him. He told me, Father, have I a way out of this? Have I a salvation with the Lord? Heal me and set me free. I told him, my friend, both that counselor and your friend, both of them did a lot of disservice to you. The counselor never understood the mercy of God. Your friend never understood the power of God. I told him, you cannot make a decision and come out of this because you are a slave. A slave cannot make a decision to become free. And yet, God can set you free, and that's what Jesus came for. I read out to him this particular passage from the Luke's Gospel. I told him, Jesus is telling you today, in your hearing, at this moment, the promise is coming true in your life. The promise of salvation, promise of liberation for the oppressed, and freedom for the enslaved. You are oppressed, you are enslaved, and the Lord is setting you free at this moment. But I told him, the one thing to be done is not to make a decision. You will not commit a sin. You can't keep that decision. The one thing to be done is to surrender your life to Jesus and tell Jesus, my Lord, my life belongs to you. My hands belong to you. My eyes belong to you. My legs belong to you. I give you the ownership, the freedom of my life. I want to be your slave. You tell me what to do, I'm ready to obey. Once you make that decision to make a surrender in the hands of the Lord will give you the power of the Holy Spirit to live a life of freedom. But then I told him, you must experience that surrender at every moment. It's not enough to say that I surrender my life. No, you must continually say it. Every time you want to move your leg, you must consult the Lord. Shall I go there or shall I not go there? What is the will of my God? My eyes, God has given me my eyes, the ownership of my eyes, I surrender to Jesus. And therefore, my eyes will look at only at such things that the Lord would permit me to look at. I will use my eyes only according to the will of my Jesus. My hands will move as being moved by the Holy Spirit. My voice will be raised as dictated to me by the Lord, because my voice, my eyes, my hands, my legs don't belong to me. They belong to Jesus. The ownership is written and given to him. And he will tell me what to do. He will tell me where to look at. He will tell me where to go. Make that surrender to the Lord and renew that surrender. Whenever you are tempted to look at an unholy picture, renew your surrender. My Lord, my eyes belong to you. I can't look at that picture. I take my eyes away. Whenever I feel like shouting at someone, I must tell myself, my Lord, my voice belongs to you. I cannot hurt someone with my voice. Whenever I want to go, I'm compelled to go somewhere, I tell my Lord, my legs, the movement of my legs does not belong to me. You are the owner of my legs, and my legs will move only as being moved by you. Continually make that surrender. But brothers and sisters, that's what surrender is. Yes, I have my hands, I have my legs, I have my eyes, and yet I need the permission of my Jesus, my master, to move them, to use them, because I'm a slave of Jesus. Jesus is my Lord, and that means I need his permission to move my hands, to use my eyes. My life belongs to him. A total surrender in the hands of the Lord. Dear friends, that's when we experience salvation. That's when we experience liberation. That's when we experience freedom and forgiveness. That's when we become free for Jesus, who offered his life on the cross for my salvation. We become one with him. Today, the Lord is asking us to make a very honest soul searching. We could be slaves, as St. Paul said, slaves of hot temper. As someone said, anger is hanging down my nose. It easily slips into my mouth, and then the things I shout at people. You're a slave, my brother. You're a slave of the hot temper, of the anger. A wonderful lady once told me, Father, when my husband gets the pay, monthly pay, that's the day I'm most happy. I go to the mall, supermarket. I buy. I go on buying. When I buy, I know I don't need these clothes. I will never wear these clothes, and yet I cannot stop buying. I buy them and bring them to the room and keep them somewhere. the next month I buy again. An irresistible urge, a slavery, a woman who could never control herself. And you and I, we could have such areas in our life. We could be lazy, we could be keeping an anger against someone, hating someone. We could be having unholy relationships. We're not able to say no to it. A smoking habit, a drug addiction. We could be slaves, my dear sisters and brothers. And yet, the Lord is giving us the good news. Every slave will be set free. All that is needed is to turn to the Lord, accept Jesus as the Lord and Savior of our lives.